Hi everyone, welcome back to my class. This is Rumana Ali. I hope you all are fine. In the last session, I have explained you about the different steps that are involved in the process of respiration. Now in today's class, let us learn about the mechanism. We have seen that breathing involves two main steps, inhalation and exhalation. So how the inhalation would take place, what are the different things that happen due to which the air enters into our body? Simply the air would not enter. Because of certain things, they enters into our body. So now in today's class, let us learn about the mechanism of breathing. Before we learn about the mechanism of breathing, firstly, we'll see the different sides of our body, and also we'll learn about the thoracic cavity once again, and we'll see where the lungs are located and which bones are covering that visceral organ. Right, so when you look at the human body, then our body shows four sides. Four main sides are present. The side which faces towards the front side, this part is called as ventral side. And the part which faces towards our back, so this side is called as dorsal side. And downside of the human body, the parts which faces downwards, they are termed as posterior part, or the side is termed as posterior side. So here, the front side is our ventral side, the back side is our dorsal side. This one is our anterior side, and this one is our anterior side, and downward, the part which faces downwards, that is called as posterior side. So these are the four sides of a human body. Why we are learning about these four sides, later I'll tell you within a minute. So firstly, we'll see, we all know that our body consists of two main cavities. The upper portion of our body consists of two main cavities, thoracic cavity and abdominal cavity. We are not going to learn about abdominal cavity because the organs which are present in the abdominal cavity, they are not involved in the process of exchange of gases or breathing. Only the parts that are present in the thoracic cavity, they are responsible to carry out the process of respiration. So we are just focusing on our thoracic cavity in this chapter. So the thoracic cavity of the human body is like a drum, and inside the drum all the visceral organs, internal organs like lungs and heart is present. So this is our thoracic cavity. If you cut at the anterior side of the human body, whatever the things that you can see inside the body, that I'm drawing here. So it's like a drum. And here in the ventral side of the human body, in between, one bone is present. Here the lungs are found, and even heart is also present in between somewhere. So like this. And the pleural fluid is also present. Now, to protect these lungs, some bones are coming from the back side. This is our dorsal side. How in the center of the ventral side a bone is present? This bone is called as sternum. Likewise, at the back, in between our dorsal side, one bone is present again, and that bone is made up of small bones, and this whole backbone can be termed as vertebral column. Now this vertebral column, some bones are going to initiate from the sides of this vertebral column like this, C-shaped bones, and from the vertebral column they are going to come and attach to the sternum. So in this way, the bones are coming from the vertebral column and they are attaching to the sternum, and in this way all the bones are coming, they are forming an outer covering over the lungs, and these bones are C-shaped. From the back they are coming in front, so in this way they are arranged, and these C-shaped bones are called as ribs. And at the end, like this lobe shaped structure is present. This lobed shaped structure is called as diaphragm, right? In the last session, I have already explained you about the different fluids. The covering of the lungs shows some membranous structures, and these membranous structures are called as visceral pleura and the walls of the thoracic cavity shows the presence of parietal pleura, and in between the parietal pleura and the visceral pleura some fluid is present, and this fluid is called as pleura, or we can say pleural fluid, right? So once again, let's recall all these parts. On the ventral side of the human body, a bone is present that is called as sternum. To this bone, all the ribs are going to attached, and these ribs are coming from the vertebral column. Vertebral column is a bone that is made up of many small bones, and that vertebral column is present at the dorsal side, at the back side of the human body. So from the back side, the bones are coming and attaching at the ventral side to the sternum, and these bones that are coming from the vertebral column and attaching to the sternum, they are called as ribs. At the end of the thoracic cavity, we can find one lobed shaped structure, and this lobe shaped structure is called as diaphragm. Lungs are also present. This is like a drum, right? Inside the drum, lungs are kept, and these lungs are surrounded by a membranous structure called visceral pleura. Walls of the thoracic cavity shows parietal pleura. In between the parietal and visceral pleura, fluid is present. That fluid is called as pleural fluid. So this is how the arrangement of the visceral organ can be seen in the body. So it's like a room, and inside the room, these lungs are kept in a fluid. Now, in between these ribs, some muscles are present. The two ribs are present. So, in between these two ribs, some muscles are present. Some of the muscles are located outside of the ribs, and some of the muscles are located inner side of the ribs. So, the muscles that are present externally at the outermost region, they are called as external intercostal muscles. So in between these two ribs, some muscles are found, and these muscles are called as intercostal muscles. In science, we need to learn many difficult terms and many different terms we need to learn. We have learned that whenever the word hepato comes, we should think about the liver. It's about liver. So, whenever the word gastric or gastro comes, then it is talking about the stomach. So, likewise, the different terms are given to the different internal organs. And here also, if you find the word costal, then you should think about the ribs. We are talking about the ribs here. So, whatever the muscles that are present in between the two ribs, they are called as intercostal muscles. The movement, the contraction of intercostal muscles and the diaphragm causes the process called inhalation. The location of the lungs, the covering, the bones that are protecting the lungs, the fluid which is present, everything we have learned. So, the thoracic chamber is made up of sternum, that is present ventrally, and vertebral column. Vertebral column is our backbone. So, backbone is present dorsally, the sternum is present ventrally, and ribs are arranged laterally, and the diaphragm is present on the lower side. That means the diaphragm is present posteriorly. So all these, sternum, vertebral column, ribs and diaphragm, makes up our thoracic chamber. We know that breathing involves two steps, inhalation, exhalation. Inhalation means taking the air in. When the air moves into the lungs, that process is called as inhalation. Exhalation means giving the air out. Removal of air is called as exhalation. So here, inhalation can also be termed as inspiration, and exhalation can also be called as expiration. Firstly, we will see the mechanism of inhalation. What happens when the air enters into our body? How it happens? How the air gets into the lungs? How the air can move into the lungs? So it is due to some pressure. From where the pressure exerted. Now we are going to see the mechanism of inhalation. So in the process of inhalation, when the air pressure of the lungs reduces at the time the atmospheric air can rushes into the lungs. The air that is present in the atmosphere, it can moves into the lungs whenever the air pressure of the lungs gets reduces. So how we can reduce the air pressure of the lungs? That I'm going to explain you in a minute. Before this, we need to understand one law, we need to recall one law, and that is our Boyle's law. So Boyle's law explains one point, and that Boyle's law can be taken to understand the mechanism of inhalation. So the Boyle's law explains, or it states, that the pressure of the container is inversely proportional to the volume. So Boyle's law states that the pressure of the container is inversely proportional to the volume. What does it mean? Let us take one example to understand this law. So here we are going to take one big container and one small container. In both of these containers, we are taking 10 molecules of air. So here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. Here also we are taking 10 molecules of air. When you see the air molecules that are present inside the container, in both of the container, the air exerts some of its pressure at the walls of the container. Always the air exerts some pressure. So here also the air molecules, they will exert some pressure at the walls of the container. In the case 2, that is in the small container also, they are going to exert some pressure at its walls. But the pressure that is exerted by the air molecule is more in the small container when compared to the large container. So this is how we can explain the point, the pressure of the container is inversely proportional to the volume. If the space is more, then the pressure will be less. But if the space is less, the pressure will be more. So here in the small container, space is less, volume is less. So the pressure that is exerted by the air molecules is more. But here in the large container, the space is more. So the pressure is less. So always the pressure is inversely proportional to volume. This is what happens in the lungs, in the pressure of the lungs, and in the atmospheric air pressure, due to which the air moves, the air rushes into our lungs. So let us see how it happens. We know that in the thoracic chamber, the lungs are present, and the walls of the thoracic chamber shows the presence of parietal pleura, and the lungs, the walls of the lungs shows the visceral pleura. In between these two, fluid is present, that is pleural fluid. This pleural fluid helps in attaching both of these structures, the thoracic chamber. The walls of the thoracic chamber and the walls of the lungs are attached to each other with the help of a fluid called pleural fluid. Now, when the thoracic chamber expands, at that time, lungs are also going to expand. These lungs are balloon-like structure. When the thoracic chamber expands, automatically they are also going to expand. So due to the expansion of lungs, the air pressure, the lungs, it gets decreases when compared to the atmospheric air pressure. So always the air molecules moves from higher concentration or higher pressure to lower pressure. Now to understand this point, again we'll take one example how the air moves from higher pressure to lower pressure. In a corner of a room, if you spray a perfume, then you can feel the smell, you can sense the smell in the whole room. So how it happens? It is due to the movement of air from higher pressure to lower pressure. For example, this is our room. We are going to spray a scent at this corner. So here the molecules of the perfume are present in the high concentration. They are going to move towards the lower concentration, and in this way the fragrance can be sensed in the whole room. So this point needs to remember that the air always moves from the higher pressure to the lower pressure region. Based on this principle only, the mechanism of inhalation takes place. We have studied that whenever the thoracic chamber expands, when the thoracic chamber gets larger in size, at that time the lung size would also gets larger. So how do lungs increase their size? Now look at this diagram. We all know that sternum is present ventrally and backbone. Vertebral column is present dorsally. The bones that are coming from the vertebral column and attaching to the sternum, they are called as ribs. And the lungs are present in the thoracic cavity. And this lobe-shaped structure, which is present at the lower side, it is called as diaphragm. In between these two ribs, intercostal muscles are present. You have also seen this one. This intercostal muscles, if they are located externally, for example, these two ribs are present. These intercostal muscles, if they are present externally, then they are called as external intercostal muscles. And if they are located internally, then they are termed as internal costal muscles. So now we are just talking about external intercostal muscles. Now let us see how do lungs increase their size. So when the muscles like external intercostal muscles contract, at that time the thoracic chamber expands, due to which the ribs, they move upwards. When they move upward, at that time the thoracic chamber expands. And we know that as soon as the thoracic chamber expands, the lungs would also get expands. And when the size of the lungs increases, the air pressure gets decreases. So the air pressure gets decreases when compared to the atmospheric air pressure. Now the atmospheric air pressure is much higher than the pressure of the lungs. So automatically the air rushes into the lungs. That is, from the, it moves from the higher pressure towards the lower pressure. In this way, the air rushes into the lungs due to the expansion of the lungs, due to the upward movement of the ribs. Here, one more thing that we need to learn is, when the ribs move upward, the volume of the thoracic chamber gets increases, right? Now, as soon as the ribs move upwards, the diaphragm, which is located on the lower side, it also gets contract and it becomes like this. The lobe shaped of the diaphragm contracts, and on contraction it changes its shapes. It provides some space to the lungs in order to increase their size. So this is how the mechanism of inhalation takes place. It's very simple. Here the ribs move upward, the diaphragm moves downward. The upward movement of the ribs and the downward movement of the diaphragm provides the space for the thoracic chamber to get increases. As soon as the thoracic chamber gets increases, the lungs would also get increases. When the volume of the lungs gets increases, at that time the air pressure decreases. Just before, we have learned now, pressure is inversely proportional to volume. So when the space is more, the pressure is less. When the pressure becomes less, the atmospheric pressure is high and the air moves from higher pressure to the lower pressure, to the region of lower pressure. This is what happens during the process of inhalation. So when the air moves into the lungs, at that time the process of inhalation takes place. The movement of the air into the lungs, due to the contraction of external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm, so the movement of the air into the lungs takes place because of the contraction of external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm. The main points we are going to write here about the mechanism of inhalation. So in the process of inhalation, what happens first? Contraction of intercostal muscles takes place, and even the contraction of diaphragm can also be seen. Once they contract, what happens? The ribs, they move upwards, and due to the upward movement of the ribs, lungs and the thoracic chamber, they get expand. And due to this expansion, air pressure of the lungs gets decreases. As soon as the pressure gets decreases, the air rushes into the lungs from the atmosphere. This is what happens in the mechanism of inhalation. So after the inhalation, exhalation is also a process. It is also a step of breathing that should also occur. Now let us see the mechanism behind the process of exhalation. We have learned that during the process of inhalation, the volume of the lungs gets increases. Now that volume of the lungs should get reduces to carry out the process of exhalation. So whenever we breathe in, we can feel that the ribs are moving upward, the lungs are expanding, but they should reduces their volume for the process of exhalation. So what happens during the process of exhalation? There will be no muscle contraction. No muscle gets contracted. Already contracted muscles are relaxed. We have seen that during the process of inhalation, external intercostal muscles and diaphragm, both of them gets contracted. On contraction of diaphragm and intercostal muscles only, the inhalation would occur. So this ribs, they are going to move upward during the process of inhalation. Now they need to come back to their normal position. So here the reduce in the volume of the lungs takes place during the process of exhalation, and as soon as the volume of the lungs gets reduces, the diaphragm also comes back to its normal position. It again becomes lobed shaped. So the lobe shaped of diaphragm can be seen during the process of exhalation, and the ribs, they move downwards and the diaphragm move upwards during the process of exhalation. And exhalation is a passive process because there is no contraction that can be seen during this step. But in this step, during the process of inhalation, the muscle contraction can be seen. So the inhalation is an active process. And one more thing is, if we want to learn the mechanism in an easier manner of both these steps, then we need to remember just two points. Exhalation means ribs are moving downwards and diaphragm move upwards without any muscle contraction. Whereas inhalation means ribs rises up, they move outward, due to which the volume of the lungs increases. Whereas the diaphragm, it moves downward and the muscle contraction takes place. Due to the contraction only, the downward movement of the diaphragm takes place. So the ribs rises up and the diaphragm move downwards in the step inhalation, whereas in the step exhalation, ribs move downwards and the diaphragm rises up. It comes back to its own position. It comes back to its normal position, that is in the lobe shape. And the air which is present inside the lungs, it can releases out due to the higher air pressure and the decrease in their volume. This is how the inhalation and exhalation takes place, which are the steps of breathing. That's all for today. Meet you in next class. Thank you.